Welcome, friends, to this second day of our three-day event in MtLaurel in New Jersey. I'm very happy to see all of you again. Yesterday, in the two sessions, I explained to you that when one seeks, one finds. The secret to the spiritual path is seeking. Seeking within your heart. Seeking within your mind. No running around. We run around because we don't think anything is inside. We think everything is outside. If we knew this basic truth, that what we are seeking is within ourselves, we would not be running out so much to find what is inside us. There is a deer called the musk deer. It has a great fragrance coming from its own head. It does not know where it comes from. It runs all over the forest, ultimately searching where is this coming from, and ultimately gets so tired and falls down. We are like that. What is inside us, we are searching outside. And the simple reason for that is that what we think inside is closing your eyes and creating a darkness in front of you. These eyes, physical eyes, are designed to look outside. They are not designed to look inside. They are not pointing inwards. They are pointing outwards. So when you try to see something with these eyes, it can only see what is outside. By closing the eyes, you don't even see what is outside. You neither see what is inside nor outside. How can that be an equivalence of finding the truth within yourself? You have to use different eyes to see, different ears to hear, different hands to work with, different feet to walk with. And all these lie inside us. And we all have evidence of it. Because when we go to sleep, we have dreams in which these eyes, ears and hands and feet don't work. And yet we run around everywhere in a dream. When we imagine something, in imagination, we are able to see, touch, taste, hear, everything we can do in imagination. And none of these sense organs on the physical body have any role in that. Yesterday, we did an exercise where most of you were able to see things, touch them, smell them, taste them. You were able to use all sense perceptions without using any of the perceptions on the physical body. So that is why we have a lot of equipment within ourselves to look what is inside. And we don't have to use what is on the physical body. This physical body is designed to only work outside. The physical body is responsible for creating the experience outside. The mind uses the physical body to have experience of a physical world. Therefore, to think that we can use the physical body or any components of the physical body to find the truth about ourselves and about our true home and true abode is a mistake. People think that by performing different asanas, by putting the body in different various postures, we'll find the truth. What does the body posture do with the truth that is lying inside? Well, we say the old yogis used to do it. Have you read the history of the old yogis, why they did it? Do you know why they performed different postures of the body? Because they meditated inside small caves. And there was no place for them to do jogging or any other exercise. They designed a series of bodily positions that gave exercise to the entire body to keep the physical body fit, in which they could go within and find out the truth. The physical postures, the asanas, were not responsible for giving anybody any truth. And yet we think that just by putting the body in different positions, we are going to get the truth. This body is not designed for that. What is designed for this is something that lies inside us. That when we close our eyes, we want to disassociate from this body, not get more into the body. Some people think that the energy centers will give us the truth. The energy centers lie below the eyes. The highest energy center is at the outer eyes. And these centers, energy centers that are below the eyes, they give you energy. Energetic fields are created. All the energy you require to survive in this world comes from these centers. You have the process of digesting food, your process of circulating the blood, your process of breathing, you got process of doing all these things to sustain this body. And you think that by using energies of these kinds, you'll find the truth? I would like to meet one person who says, by using energy, I found the truth. There is a big difference between energy and awareness. This body of ours itself is divided into two parts. And the eyes in front are the dividing line. Everything below the eyes is only for energetic experiences. And everything behind and above the eyes is for higher awareness. If you go below the eyes, you will not get higher awareness. You may get higher energy. You may even have psychic powers created. You may even have out-of-body experiences created from by putting your attention on the heart center. It does not give you higher awareness. It gives you new experience. You can get all kinds of new experiences by using the body and the energy centers. Below the eyes, you will never get higher awareness. You will never wake up to a state of being where you will know the wakeful state was merely a dream. That happens when we go to sleep and we wake up in the morning. What's the difference between dream and wakefulness? What happens when you wake up in the morning? How do you know you are awake? People ask me this question, how do you know that when you are in a higher state of consciousness, it is higher consciousness and not hypnotic suggestion by which you're creating a new experience? I said, do you go to sleep? Yes. Do you wake up in the morning? Yes. Do you know it? Is it hypnotic suggestion that you are awake, or do you really know you are awake? Oh, I really know I'm awake. I said, when a person goes to sleep and wakes up in the morning, he knows he is awake not by pinching himself or checking with some other person, am I awake? He knows he is awake. If 1,000 people came to him and said, no, you are still sleeping, he'll say, no, I know I'm awake. He's not dependent on the evidence of outside. He's dependent on the evidence of his own experience. And what is that experience? When we wake up in the morning, what helps us to know that we are awake? We get linked to the point where we went to sleep. We remember we went to sleep. If we forgot we went to sleep, we will never know whether we are awake or dreaming. But when we wake up in the morning, before we have opened our eyes, before we have made any movement, lying in the bed, we know we are awake. No verification is needed for wakefulness. That is why when you raise to higher awareness, you awaken to a higher state. You don't get new experiences. Those you get every day you get right here. You can get all sorts of experiences right in the physical world. Therefore, the experience of wakefulness is entirely different. It opens up your connection with what you were before you went to sleep. When you awake from the physical wakeful state to a higher wakeful state, you remember you were there. You remember you were there much longer than you have been in the physical body. Your own memory comes back. The real secret of verifying if you are awake or not is that when you wake up, do you remember that you went to sleep? If you remember you went to sleep, you are awake. That's the key. But when you use energy centers and you come up with different kind of body positions and say, I am feeling high, there are a lot of things you can put in your mouth and feel high. Most of you know about it. Sometimes the nose, sometimes the mouth. And people get high. That's not high. High is when you can stay high all the time. When the intoxication of that high never goes away. So when you awaken to that state, and you come to know how going to sleep and waking up is a natural phenomenon. How coming into the physical body and going back after death and coming again is a natural phenomenon. When you come to know this has been happening all the time, it's nothing new. That coming into a physical body and dying is nothing new. It's just like going to sleep, having a dream and waking up. So that is why it's a big thing to know the division of the physical body. Things have been placed in this physical body in such a remarkable way. People see these 6 chakras of energy, and then they take from the eyes, they say, now the crown chakra is opened right on top, all connected with physical body and the energy of the physical body. What has awareness to do with it? What has wakefulness to do with it? How do you awaken to higher level? I'll tell you a little story. Great master, Baba Sawan Singh, he was invited by my uncle who was working in a port town in Pakistan called Karachi. He had a beautiful house there. He was a meteorologist, and he invited the master. Who was his master? He said, "Master, come and stay with me and have a little break from your heavy duties you are doing in the Dera." The master agreed. And along his little troop of people who followed, I and my dad and our family was also there. So that's one great trip I still remember, going with great master in the train all the way from the Dera to Lahore to Karachi. My uncle, who lived there, and his wife, my aunt, they used to go to a Swami, Swami Brahmananji. He was a beautiful guy, such sharp eyes. He used to wear a little turban, and he used to have orange-colored, saffron-colored robes that he used to wear, and he used to carry a little muffler type of thing that he held in his hands like this, and he kept his chin high, and he held that when he walked. It was so wonderful to see him. A great guy, Swami Brahman. He used to teach yoga to different students and was also a great expert in Ayurvedic medicine. My uncle and aunt were not going to him for learning yoga because they were following the Surtshab yoga of great master. But they would go to him to get Ayurvedic medicines. When great master agreed to go to Karachi, they went to the Swamiji and said, "Swamiji, our master is coming from Punjab and we would like you to go and have his darshan." And Swamiji said, "I'll be very happy to give him darshan. Bring him to me and I'll bless him." And that was not the intention. So they wondered how we are going to arrange this. So they came upon a good plan to invite the Swamiji to a lunch, and great master would be staying in the home. They got a love seat, a two-seated sofa, and decided to put them together and see what happens. So on the day when the lunch was fixed, Swamiji came. And he came, they seated him on the sofa. Then great master was getting ready in his own bedroom. When he came out, they requested great master, "Please sit down here." He sat next to them. And they said, "Pastor, this is Swami Brahmananji, who we talked about, that he is a great person in Ayurvedic medicine and also teaches yoga." Great master put his hands together, bowed his head and said, "Pranam, Swamiji." Swamiji raised his head like this, hand is like this. He said, "I bless you." We were watching this show. He said, "What is this going on?" We didn't expect this. Shortly after that, great master said to Swamiji, "Swamiji, what a strange situation that so many yogis and swamis are caught up in these six chakras below the eyes, and none of them are aware of the total 12 spiritual chakras that lie behind and above the eyes." Swamiji turned to him. He said, "What 12 chakras? And great master said, "Don't you know there are 18 chakras? 6 chakras of energy and 12 chakras of higher awareness." He said, "I have never heard of these 12 chakras. I have only heard of these 6 chakras. Will you please explain to them in great detail, where are these 18 chakras that you speak about?" And great master said, "Do you know, the time is short here. It's a big subject. But if you came to my Dera in the Vyas, I could tell you about them in great detail." So Swamiji's curiosity was aroused, but at night he could not sleep. And he told me, "Uncle, I have to go there. I have never heard of these 18 chakras. Always heard of 6 energy centers. Where are these 18 chakras coming from? I have to go there." He wound up his ashram, told all his devotees and all the students who studied yoga with him, "I am winding up my ashram. I am going to study about 18 chakras. That man with the white beard came up with some strange 18 chakras. I want to know what are those 18 chakras." He came to the Dera. And when he came, I was at that time doing a little practice of homeopathic remedies. And he was an expert in Ayurvedic remedies. The great master had given me a small little place for a clinic. He gave a next door place to him for a clinic. But he ordered that Swamiji will stay in the best guest suite in the Dera. they will be attendants upon him at all times. He should be served the best food. He should be treated like a VVIP and given all attention. And he will have the right to meet me 24/7 whenever he likes. When this information was conveyed to Swamiji, he felt very happy and he tugged upon us. He felt good. And he was a great guest house, big guest house. He was staying there, attendants upon him all the time. He had never seen this kind of luxury. He was very happy that he has been honored. In order to see that the great master really meant that he could see him anytime, he'd go at midnight and knock on the door. Instructions were given to all doormen to open the door, wake up the great master if Swamiji comes. Swamiji would come, and the great master's instructions were open the door, he'd wake up, great master, Swamiji has come. He would get up, bring him in. Yes, Swamiji, what can I do for you? Just came because I was feeling like having your darshan. Very good, very good. I'm so happy to see you. Now go meditate. So Swamiji would come back. He tested out that he was really a very important person in the Dera. Great master said, Swamiji will sit next to me when I give my discourses. In my satsang, he will sit next to me. The chanters on this side, I'll be the center. Swamiji will sit next to me. So when the discourse took place, Swamiji was sitting next to him. And great master said, these yogis and swamis, they are all caught up in the six chakras. None know about awareness. And Swamiji would look like this. And he would, after a few days, he said, Master, I have a problem. Yes, Swamiji, what is the problem? This problem is, when you speak, I have to keep my neck turned and I got a pain in the neck. The great master said, I also noticed this. I think it's best if you sit in front. So a special chair was brought for Swamiji to sit in front. And then Swamiji would sit in front. After a few days, he complained. He said, Master, I have a little problem. He said, what is the problem now, Swamiji? Problem is that you sitting on a high stage. And when I sit there, I have to raise my head up like this. And then I got a pain in my neck again. The great master said, I also noticed that. Move his chair 20 feet behind the people. So his chair was moved behind. After a couple of days, he went to great master and said, Master, I have a little problem. What is the problem now, Swamiji? Problem is, you've given me a chair and people behind me can't see you. He said, yes, I also noticed that. Remove the chair. Put him along with the other people. Gradually, he told me, because we used to share this information sitting next door in our clinics, he told me, today I am just like any beggar in the door of this master. I have to wait in line to see him. And I can't see him except when he wants to see me. Had I known I'll be treated like this, I would never have come. I would have gone away on day one. He treated me like a VVIP and now he's put me down to where I really belong. But one thing has happened, he told me. He has trapped me with his love. I can't go anywhere. That's what's happened. I can go nowhere. He has trapped me with my love. Of course, the Swami was already doing a lot of meditation, so he made good progress quite rapidly. And we used to share our experiences. So the point I'm making is that masters act in different ways. They know our situation. But what pulls us to a master is the unconditional love of a master for us. You will never see that he can get angry with us even when we are not being good. He makes us feel from inside. We punish ourselves. There was a man, I'm remembering old stories now, but great master, you don't mind my sharing a few of these stories. There was a man who came once and he told great master, we were sitting outside, he was reading his mail and some assistants were helping great master with the mail. And a man came running. Master, forgive me. You told me not to drink alcohol. Last night, I boozed out completely. I was with friends who were all drinking. I couldn't help it. Master, you told me not to eat meat. I had all steaks and meats, whatever was there. Master, you told me not to indulge in any bad activities with women. I did everything bad. Master, forgive me. Master said, okay, you are forgiven. Don't do it again. And he said, thank you, and he ran away. The secretary sitting around the master got surprised. He said, "Master, this guy did not follow your instructions. He committed so many sins and he's confessing them to you and you say, I forgive them." Master, supposing he comes again, he says the same thing. Will you forgive him again? He said, "Yes, I think I'll forgive him again." "Master, when will you punish a man like that?" He said, "Keep me on the side of forgivers, not punishers. Each of us are carrying a punisher in our own heads. Our own mind, our own conscience, our own guilt punishes like nobody else. Therefore, we are carrying the punishers around with ourselves. Masters are always forgivers. Always. It's a great experience to have with these kind of people. How they don't judge us. Their love is so unconditional, so pure. There's no comparison with that love. And it's that love that really pulls us. Now, this from the, here I bring my real subject, that the spiritual path is a path of love and devotion, nothing else. If there is no love and devotion, there is no spirituality. Yesterday I spent all my time telling you how to withdraw your attention inside, how to vacate this body, how to get into higher awareness. And now I'm telling you, all those things are for the mind. If you want to go beyond the mind, and the spiritual regions are all above the mind, this true spirituality is above the mind, nothing will take you there except love and devotion. Love and devotion is the key. And that's how the masters come and pull us. They pull us with a love that's coming from our true home. And that love pulls us. The love makes us meditate. The love makes us do things even for the mind. The love draws us to their presence. The love wants their darshan, wants to see them. It's the pull of the love that works. And therefore, to say that the spiritual path consists of any kinds of yoga or practices is just for the mind. The mind has to be satisfied. The mind does not believe that you can get anything without a struggle. So master says, struggle. Meditate more. Meditate more. Mind says, yeah, now I'm on my way. Now I can do something. But this goes only up to the level of the mind. To go beyond the mind, you need nothing but love and devotion. After all, by chanting names, physical words, how can you go to spiritual regions? Nobody had designed a mantra so far. Never heard of a mantra that could take you beyond the mind. Mantras don't even take you to the mind. Not even to the universal mind. They take you at the most to the stage, astral stage, which is where the heavens lie. And we think heavens are our true home. Those are merely places like the physical world where we go with our karma. Bad karma, go to hell. Good karma, go to heaven. They are only one stage above from here. They are not our true home at all. There the time is limited like here. Time flows there like here. It's not beyond time and space. Even the causal region where the universal mind is not away from time and space. If you want to go to a true home where the soul belongs, where you belong in your truth, that is beyond the mind. That's our true home. And only love and devotion takes us there. The reason is simple. I mentioned yesterday that there are some functions the mind performs and some functions the soul performs. The mind's functions are to reason, to make sense of perceptions, sense perceptions, to put them together, to use logic to come to conclusions, to make sense of things, and to interpret sense perceptions. That's the job of the mind. And it's doing a good job. To think out things is a good job. To be able to speak, communicate, good job. But none of these involve love or intuition, intuitive knowledge, or appreciation of beauty. Mind cannot do that. When we say we appreciate something, you look out, wonderful view we are looking at. It cannot come from the mind. Supposing you have a nice big painting, and you look at the painting, beautiful. I appreciate this painting. Is it coming from the mind or the soul? Only soul can take it. What will the mind do? It'll analyze it step by step. Supposing you have a nice painting and you cut it into 1,000 pieces, 1-inch squares. You can see those squares 1,000 times. You'll never see the beauty of the painting. The mind analyzes. The mind breaks up things. Mind, to understand anything, wants to break it up. It's an analytical tool. The soul is synthesis. It puts together. It takes a grand, big view. They're two different functions. Therefore, when we function, and both are functioning together right now. So when we are talking of spirituality, we are talking of the functions of intuitive knowledge, love and appreciation of beauty and enjoying bliss. Bliss does not come from the mind. Bliss is a spiritual thing. That is why there's a big distinction between the two. And when we say that a master pulls us by love, that's because it is spiritual activity. It's a spiritual pull that he pulls us with. And our love and devotion is also spiritual. Why do we use the words love and devotion? Because we don't know how to love. We know how to be attracted to things. We know how to tell people who we are attracted to, I love you. When a person says, I love you, examine who is he loving. And I'll tell you who is loving. He's loving I. When he says, I love you, it's an ego trip. Because supposing you say, ah, but I don't, I hate you. Then he will say, I also hate you. What kind of love is that? It's an ego trip. It's a putting a patronizing thing. Therefore, this expression, which is so commonly used, is for attachments. We get pulled by attachments. There's something attractive, we are pulled by that. That's not love. We are attracted to all these things around us, people and objects, and we are attracted to them. We get attached to them. That's not love. Attachment is different. In attachment, you will always have the experience of two. I and you. When a person says, I love you, what's his awareness say? There is I, there is you, we have a good connection. That's what we call love. It's not love at all. What happens in true love? You all have had experience of true love. You forget who you are. The beloved is only there in your picture. You replace your I with the beloved, with the one you love. You think of the you. You don't think of I. That's true love. So you experience this true love when you are in the presence of somebody who can give you pure love. These masters are example of how you can experience pure love because they stretch out the real true love for you and you're touched by it. Your response to that love is called devotion. You want to do anything for them just because of devotion. You love them again because of devotion. So when we use the expression, love and devotion is the key to higher spirituality, we are talking of the love experience, which comes pure love from one who can come from the spiritual region. And then we are devoted because we respond to that love. So love and devotion is the secret of the highest spiritual realm that we can go to. When we meditate, it has to be done with love and devotion to make it real. Not a mechanical thing. Mechanical meditation does not lead us anywhere. Just mechanically doing something keeps you where you are. It may give you a little bit of satisfaction. It may raise your ego. I have done so much meditation. Sometimes the ego is boosted by the fact you meditate so much and got nothing out of it. People come and say, I've been meditating for 40 years. Very good, congratulations. What did you get out of it? Well, I think I felt a lot at peace. I said, I saw you quarreling with your wife yesterday. Oh, that's a domestic matter. I have inner peace. But when my wife interferes with my inner peace, I fight. Look at this situation. I come across these situations all the time. What kind of meditation is that which does not take away your anger, which does not take away your attachments, which does not take away your ego, which does not take away your possessiveness, which does not take away your greed? What kind of meditation is that? If you truly meditate with love and devotion, these things disappear. Gradually, each one of them disappears. When you go above the mind, all of them disappear. You can test it out and you will meet those people who have ever gone into the spiritual realm. They have none of these things. They are not detached. They are detached, but they love. Love is not attachment. They love purely. They love everybody and there is no attachment involved. They can be detached and love with compassion. Their compassion is immense because they see how we are trapped. We can't see our own trap. We don't even know that the body is a prison. We think it's something to enjoy. It's a big prison in which we are trapped in time and space and physical immobility. We can not even fly with the body. It's such a strange kind of prison. Yet we think we are in a great state. This body is what we have to get out of. And yet we think that the body is something that the most rarest thing, that we should enjoy life and then we'll die one day. Eat, drink and be merry. Tomorrow you die. This is our philosophy. Which of course reminds me of a little story. Before we meditate, I'll tell you that story. I don't know why I'm in a storytelling mood today. Once upon a time, there was an Indian merchant. He used to go to Africa for import-export business. He would carry some Indian silks and spices and things to Africa and bring cashew nuts and some other nuts from Africa. He used to deal in these different commodities. He would take his stuff to Africa, sell them, and bring African things, sell in India. One day he went through an African forest. There were a lot of parrots there. And he looked at those parrots. They were so beautiful. He said, I want to take one of them with me. So he bought a cage and captured one parrot and brought him back to India. He took care of the parrot in the cage. He fed him with famous parrot food. I don't know if you know what is the best parrot food, what is the favorite food. It is green or red chilies and a thing made like called churi. Churi and chilies are his famous. Churi is made, you put some flour, you put some oil, ghee, something, put some sugar, become very tasty thing. Parrots love them. If you've got parrots, you can try. And the parrot was fed with nice churi, given chilies, and the parrot would dance and laugh and sing and was taught all those good things. Next year, when he was about to leave for Africa, he asked his parrot, he said, Mr. Parrot, I am going to your homeland. Do you have any message for the people back home? He said, yes, tell them I am enjoying my life in this cage. I eat churi, I eat chilies, and I like to sing and dance. I'm very happy. So the merchant went to Africa. After finishing his business, he went to that forest and he saw all the parrots. He said, come here, all of you. I have a message for you from the parrot I took with me last year. So all the parrots assembled. And he said, my parrot in India sent you a message that he enjoys his life in the cage where he gets churi and chilies and he sings and dances and is very happy. On hearing this, one old parrot sitting on a branch nearby had tears in his eyes. And when he looked at the tears of the parrot fell down dead. He was so sad that this parrot must have been very close to the one I took that he could not bear to hear his message. Anyways, feeling sorry, he returned. When he came back, he told his parrot in the cage that I conveyed your message. But when I told them that you are enjoying your life in this cage and you eat churi and chilies and all that, one senior parrot had tears in his eyes and he fell down dead. On hearing this, the parrot in the cage had tears in his eyes and he fell down dead. He said, oh, stupid merchant, you should have realized if these two parrots were so close to each other, why did you convey this message? Anyway, disappointed, he opened the cage, threw the dead parrot outside. As soon as he threw the parrot outside, the parrot opened his wings and flew up and sat up on a tree. He said, so you aren't dead after all? He said, no, nor is the one in the forest. He just sent me a message to you. The message was, if you want to get out of the cage, die while living. That's how we make it a spiritual message. The point is that this body which we think is so rare, it is rare. It has got some features. But it is not, it's not our freedom. It impedes our freedom. We can't do anything with this body. We think we can. Lot of things. They're nothing compared to what we can do even with the next body, which can fly, which can communicate with anybody, no matter what language they speak. Here, if I don't know Greek and a Greek person comes to me, speaks in Greek, I can't understand him. In the astral plane, you can speak in any language, and a person who knows none of that language can understand you. Because the communications, at this very first stage I'm talking of, the communication is telepathic. In telepathic communication, you don't convey words of a message, you convey the meaning of a message. Even physical telepathy, I don't know how many of you have had telepathic communication. If you have seen that, you sit in Germany, somebody is thinking in German, and you telepathically get the message, you understand in your language. It's not the language that is being transmitted, it's the meaning of what you want to convey. Language is merely symbols, phonetic symbols of what you want to convey. And that's conveyed here also. Telepathy is normal communication there. Also, here you can keep secrets. And a lot of troubles are arising because people keep secrets. A lot of distress is caused in the physical world because of secrets. There you can't keep a secret, everybody can read your mind. So it's a different kind of life. But in a way this is better, in a way that is better. All I'm saying is that there is certain mobility and freedom that we don't have here. But you can experience at different other levels. The highest level, we are totally free. We are free to do anything, create any universe as we like. And that's a very different ball game than what we are sitting here. And we are that soul. We are that spiritual unit that is linked with the ultimate power, never separated. So it's a state of wakefulness. We can awake to the highest level and discover who we are. So love and devotion is the key. You can start right from day one. Even when you are trying to do mechanical meditation, put some love and devotion into it. One of the big features of having a master, living master, with whom you can experience love, is that you have somebody to focus your love on when you meditate. Otherwise, you can love anybody, but that person, you may not be sure of that love. It may not be pure love. It may be mixed up with attachments, mixed up with ego, and then doesn't work. If you had a pure beloved right here, you could also have that same experience of love inside your head. But a perfect living master is a good example. Some people say, what is the need of a master? Some people say, why do we have a master when you say that God, the ultimate creator, ultimate power is lying inside you? We don't want an outside agent to help us go inside our own self. The truth is, there is no outside agent that's helping you. What you think as an outside agent is merely a reflection outside of the inside agent, of your own self. You are the ultimate master, but you don't know it. You come down and separate yourself from everybody, including your God, including your master. Therefore, an outside person appears in your life. And he does not say, I'll lead you from outside. I'll take you to a temple. I'll take you to a sky. I'll take you to a river. I'll take you to do this. That's not spirituality. He says, I'll take you, help you to go within your own self. And you will find me. You won't find somebody else. I'll be there. So the true master is always inside. We are not taking any agent outside. We are finding the truth within ourselves. We don't know. We close our eyes and we think we are inside. We are not. That's why we need somebody to help us. So therefore, when we need a master because we can't see our own self. If we could see ourselves, we don't need one. But we can. We don't even know who we are. So therefore, we need a master. But the second important part is, situated where we are, we want to have the experience of pure love which can pull us to the highest stage above the mind. And that becomes available from a perfect living master whose love pulls us and is unconditional. So that is why, if you have a master, living master, perfect living master. Now again, I can understand perfect master, one who has gone beyond the mind. What about living master? Why do we need a living master? Why can't we have an enlightened master who came in the past and left literature for us to read, scriptures, and he's left all the information for us to act upon it? The reason is simple. You've never seen that person. You have made a mental image of that person. Nobody can make better than a mental image of a person who is not there. And when you speak to a master who is dead, you are speaking to your own mind. The mind is making up that master. There is no check on it at all. Your mind says, do this. You say, master saying, do this. If a human being was there and he was your master, he would say, no. Inner mind never says that. Therefore, we have to be very careful that not to play in the hands of the mind, which is our only obstacle to realizing the truth about our own self. That is why it's important to have not only a perfect master, a perfect living master and a living master exactly like us. If he is not like us, he can't help us. If he is sitting in the sky, he may be living somewhere, we can't even see him. If a person says to me, I have never seen my master, but I know him. I say, why don't you worship an old master, a dead master also? If you've never seen a master, if you've never seen a master, how do you appreciate the love of a master? Are you not talking to your mind? Where is the guarantee that you are really talking to something higher than your own mind? So that is why it's important to have a perfect living master who should be like us, who can befriend us, who can hold our hand. There was a Muslim Sufi master. His name was Sheikh Farid. Sheikh Farid has been mentioned, he was also a Muslim, mentioned in Hindu literature. His name appears again and again in the Guru Granth Sahib of the Sikh literature. He was a well-known great mystic. Sheikh Farid had a son, and he used to tell this son, son, get initiated by my master, Qutbuddin. Sheikh Qutbuddin was Farid's master. And he would tell his son, son, time for you, time is, don't waste time. Master is getting old. He may die. He's a physical body. He's just a living master in a physical body. Go and get initiated. Don't lose time. And son, like all other sons, would say, Dad, you know I'm young. I have to still live my life. Oh, after a while I will go. Ultimately, Qutbuddin died. And Farid's son ran there and shaved off his head, which was the custom there to get before initiation. Shaved off his head. And the body of Qutbuddin was lying there. He put his head right on the feet of Qutbuddin, said, initiate me. And his father, Farid, was looking at him. And he said, son, I am sorry. You are putting your head on the body of a person I have respected more than anybody in my life. And yet I tell you, you got nothing. Even 1 second is too late. He's gone. He's not in the body. This is a piece of flesh left. You missed the opportunity. Then Sheikh Farid says, a Sheikh must hold the hand of a person to make sure you are a friend of that person and he can take you back home. This is not a game of belief on something. If we can believe on something that is far away, how is it different from something that is way back in time? If something is far away in space, how can that be different from something that's far away in time? It has to be an experience with a living master, a perfect living master, perfect who is beyond the mind. Mind creates all the imperfection. If you go beyond the mind, it's all perfect. All imperfections are created by the mind. So you have to see that you are able to hold the hand of a perfect living master in order to experience that love which can take you beyond. And then I want to tell you a little bit about what is initiation by a perfect living master. A lot of people ask me, and a lot of people have a misunderstanding. They think that teaching how to meditate is initiation. Not at all. Anybody can teach you. I teach how to meditate in every talk I give, in every workshop I do. That doesn't mean people get initiated. So many teachers are doing that. Books can teach you how to meditate. That's not initiation by a perfect living master. The perfect living master's initiation has nothing to do with teaching. He is not a teacher. He has come as a friend to take us back to our true home because we are ready for it. And when he says, come, I'll take you home, that's initiation. When he says, I accept you, I'll be with you as your permanent friend, that's initiation. Initiation takes place inside, at the third eye center, not outside. A master does not initiate you by telling you how to meditate. He initiates you by becoming your friend forever. Forever means till eternity, not for this life, not for one life or two lives, but forever. That friendship is what constitutes initiation. And sometimes we think, some people are initiated and they don't know. Again, I'll tell you a story, a true story. A poor man from a village in India had a dream that he saw a great master in his dream. And it was so pulling, he was so pulled by that dream. He said, I have to go and see him. He was so poor, he could not afford even a bus ticket. He took a little piece of cloth, tied up a few essentials with him, carried on his back and started a march walking. He was so far away from the Dera He got all the information from other satsangis, other followers of the great master. And he trudged along. Took about a month to reach the Dera. And so poor. And as it happened, on the day he arrived at the Dera, I was there standing. Great master was just coming out of his house, standing outside the door. I and about 15 other people were there, standing there, when we saw this man coming. When he came near, he looked at great master. He threw that little bundle down, ran to him and caught his feet. Master, I've come. Initiate me. In Punjabi, he said, give me naam. And the master looked at him. He says, what, once again? That's the first time he's seeing him. He said, what, once again? And then suddenly, realizing that the man didn't understand what he said, oh, you mean, no, I initiated you when you left your village. But the formality of it, I will do it tomorrow morning. And he gave him 5 words to repeat, and he told him how to listen to the sound inside. The teaching part, he gave him next day. He initiated a month earlier. Let us not mistake initiation by learning how to do meditation. There are thousands of ways to do it, and there are thousands of methods, and masters have sometimes modified the method of teaching how to meditate, depending upon what the person can do. Masters have even modified the words that they tell. They can change the mantra. Masters can utter any words and make it into a mantra. It's not the words, it's not spoken words that can take us anywhere. It's the love and the connection, the association that they're putting of themselves in those words that's making them effective. That is why we need a perfect living master, a living person like ourselves, within reach, where we can hold his hand. But one good thing is, if you have held the hand of such a person, it never goes away. Because the initiation establishes that master inside us at the third eye center. And when we go there, we may have some experiences of flying through the sky. We may have some experiences of seeing the stars and the moon. We may have seen experience of seeing a white sky. When we fly through it, we see the radiant form of our master. And we know instantly, that's the same guy who talked to us outside. He's really inside us. Once you establish that, and according to me, that's the most important thing one can do when a master is alive, you are alive, before he dies, establish the radiant form of the master inside. He'll never leave you. He'll be your friend 24/7. You'll never be lonely again. You'll have a constant companionship, a companionship of which there is no equal. That is something so unique in a relationship with a perfect living master. He establishes himself inside you. Supposing you have not done enough homework to be able to see him, he's still there. Sometimes you can talk to him. Sometimes you can feel his presence. Sometimes you can get instructions. And then he will tell you in his own words when he initiates you the checks that your mind will not become the master. If the mind pretends to be your master, you can dissolve that with some little tips that he gives you. There's a check which we can't get otherwise. Our mind always assumes it can make any picture of a master and say, I'm talking to the master. But he gives us also a check how not to have that trouble with the mind. He gives you the way to check if it's the mind making up or no. With these safeguards, it's such a wonderful experience to go through. Now here I am really talking very personal experience. This is, I am not talking from books. I am not talking from anything that I've read from outside. I am talking from experience with this man. Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh, great master. It's this experience speaking. That's why there's nothing like experience. The whole path is based upon experience. Not on faith, pure blind faith. Living faith, faith that grows every day when new things happen. You say, how could this coincidence happen? How could this miracle happen? This looks miraculous. It's not normal course of things. That builds up faith, step by step. It grows. Ultimately, it becomes unshakable, an unshakable faith. When you discover, you found. When I was very young, I used to say, is the master real? Let me test him out. So I would say, I am going to the railroad station late. I hope the train will be late. Otherwise, I'll miss the train. Train was late. I said, Master, you passed. Next day, I would try again, something else. After I had done about 9 or 10 tests, the master called me one day. He said, are you going to keep on testing or are you going to move forward also? But the faith builds up with these experiences. These experiences take place in our life. People say a thing like coincidence. What is coincidence? Coincidence is not an accident. Coincidence is a synchronicity of something happening which is against the law of probability. It would not happen probably, but it happens. And we say, that was amazing coincidence. These coincidences are no accidents. They are an expression of the miracles that are happening and are indicating to you, you are on the right path. There will be another interesting thing you will notice when you are following the spiritual path. That when you are having an intuitive feeling, intuitively gut feeling says, this is it. You're driving your car, I know this is it. You see a sign, unrelated, but few words of that are exactly what your intuition is saying. In other words, these coincidental happenings outside coincide with your intuitive gut feeling inside, giving you further verification. Something is going on. These are the kinds of little events, both outside and inside, that develop and build up our faith, and ultimately making it an unshakable faith. Meditation should be so enjoyable. It should not be a chore. Oh, I have to do 2.5 hours today. That's no meditation. Meditation is something to enjoy, something to wait for the beloved, to have a meeting with the beloved. It's something so different from what we have sometimes been doing. So that is why this meditation with love and devotion, that will carry us, that will take us. A perfect living master appears when he appears either physically in front of us or internally in our imagination or at the radiant form. When he appears in any form whatsoever, he is carrying with him his awareness of our true home. He has not had a trip to his true home and come back to tell us. This is some mistake we sometimes make. A perfect living master in a human body, when he talks to us, he is not talking from something he remembered or something he had an experience with. He is talking from what he is having the experience right there when he is talking. Because when you reach the top, you find that all regions, all experiences are created from there. And you hold all of them together. Not only the master, you too, whoever has reached there, holds all this whole show together. Knows exactly how all these have been placed. How different levels of experiences have been created. Therefore, when a perfect living master in a human form appears, he will appear and act completely normal because he wants to be a friend at this level. But his awareness is of all levels at the same time. He's not talking from, he doesn't talk from what he recalls, he talks from what he's seeing, what he's experiencing right there. So there's a big difference. When we reach that point, we become one with the only one that's there. And all this thing becomes clear. And even when we are in a physical body or any other level of consciousness, the whole awareness remains open. Otherwise, till we reach that point, we only have one reality in front of us. When we are the physical body, physical reality is our only reality. We go into dream state, the dream state becomes the only reality. We wake up, this becomes the reality, that becomes the dream. We go to the astral plane, physical disappears. Everything disappears except the astral reality. We go to causal reality, that is the only reality. Everything disappears. But when you reach the top, all realities become unreal and all realities become visible to you at the same time. You come to know how they have been created to become realities. That none of them are real. The only reality is yourself. The creative power. That you created all experiences and made them real. We did not create this great creative power, did not create illusions or shadows, it created realities. One reality upon another, each one more real than the other. So that is why when you reach that point, which the perfect living masters have reached, you retain that experience of all realities, which you know how they will build up as realities. So a perfect living master does not learn something and teach us. He's sharing his direct experience with us at all times, at all levels, whether outside or inside. So that's a big difference. There are so many teachers, and I keep on reminding people that perfect living masters are not teachers. They become teachers for the sake of our mind. Our mind likes to be taught. Therefore, they teach. Otherwise, their method is, come, you are ready, we have come at the right time. By the way, who arranged this right time? Who arranged which is the right time to go back home? Who arranged that a master would come and take us? We ourselves, in our own original state, when we decided to have these experiences, we knew we could be locked out. We were very intelligent. We knew we are not going to be locked out. We have a key for that. This was the key we established ourselves. That when we have had enough experience, we get tired of it, we'll open the key and get back. The key was the perfect living master appearing in a human form. We arrange this key ourselves. We arrange the timing ourselves. So that is why it's a complete system. It's a complete system of getting into experiences and going back to the source, to the origin. So I hope you will be able to enjoy meditation in a slightly different way by the methods I'm telling you. And even if you've been meditating for long, introduce this element. I remember another instance I mentioned, the other day, of a friend of mine in India, Punjab. He's passed away, so I can take the name also, Hira Singh. He was a disciple of Great Master. We were both initiated by the Great Master. He lived in a small town called Ludhiana in Punjab. And there, he had a foundry and he had a little factory. And attached to the factory was his house. He had a big house and a big compound. All the masters, including Great Master, at some point visited that house. Many other masters, he would invite any master. No matter what lineage or what, any master, any holy person would come, he would invite him and hear the good words they had to say. All holy people had something nice to say. So he would gather the local people, have a little satsang and enjoy them. I went to India accompanied by an American friend. And we both went and I was taking him around to show him the old Dera where we used to meditate, where we used to live. And then I said, I'll take you to this town and introduce you to the man who's still alive and he's a great master disciple. When we went there, there was a master giving a discourse in his house on the compound. So we stood outside, just behind, and the master watched us, so he called us in front. So I went up, I said, Master, I knew him because I have known all the masters, many of them when they were little kids, in their mother's arms, now they're masters, so many of them. So I happened to know, so I said, Master, finish your discourse, and I brought a guest from America, and we want to meet you. He said, Satsang finished. And he got up and said, come in. So he interrupted his meeting in the middle. He was very kind, very affectionate. My friend was very impressed. But then there were other people who began to ask me some questions. So I began to answer their questions like I do now here or I do anywhere else. From whatever I know, I answer the questions. Hira Singh came up to me, my colleague, great master disciple. And he said, Ishwar Puri, I have a question to ask you. I said, what can I do for you, my dear friend? He said, I noticed that you have something in you. I don't know how much. It's enough for you to answer people's questions. I have been meditating with the same teaching, with the same initiation that you got. I've meditated more than 40 years. I have had no experience. I certainly haven't any experience to be able to answer those questions that you are doing. How come there is so much difference amongst us? That we are both followers of the same master. We are both following the same teachings. I have followed the instructions regularly. I meditate 2.5 hours without fail since I was initiated. And I follow strict diet, vegetarian diet, no drinking, no drugs. I follow all rules exactly as laid down. I haven't had any experiences of the kind that you seem to talk about, that you seem to be answering from. Why this difference? I said, why are you asking me this question? You met all the masters, including great master. He came to your house. Why didn't you ask him that I am making no progress? He said, I did ask them. So what did they say? They smiled and said, keep on doing your meditation with love and devotion. He said, then you ask other masters also. They all gave the same answer. But you tell me, because you are answering people, I want to get this answer from you. I said, do you know, let me tell you a secret. I don't answer anybody's questions. I check with my master. Then my master tells me what to answer, I give that answer. It's not mine at all. He said, go check with your master and tell me. I said, master is not available so easily. I have to get the time from him to check. He says, how long does it take? I said, about 6 months. I check with my master that here is a colleague of mine, initiated by you, and he's been practicing this meditation for 40 years and got no experience. There must be something that the master will be able to answer. He said, okay, I'll wait. I gave him 6 months. I'm taking you into confidence. I took 6 months because I was coming back to the United States. I had no time. I had to go back after 6 months only. After 6 months, I went back and I met him. He said, did you get the answer? I said, yes. What was the answer great master gave you to convey to me? I said, he said, tell Hira Singh to continue his meditation with love and devotion. The same answer all the masters have been giving you all the time. He said, but I have been doing that. I said, sorry, you have been doing meditation, but not with love and devotion. That was the missing part. You thought it's a mechanical process. Close your eyes, keep a tab on the watch. 2.5 hours, struggling, mind is running around. You are repeating words, words are forgotten. Other thoughts are coming. Oh, fighting, tired. Meditation, terrible experience. 2.5 hours of torture. You've been doing it again and again, torturing yourself. It was not meditation. Meditation is when the master can be remembered and loved and his love experienced. And you respond to it. You show your love. You're meeting a master inside. It's like remembering your beloved like nothing else. How can that be a torture? Talk to the master. Have you ever talked inside? No, I never saw him. How could I talk? Did you imagine him? Do you even remember him? Did you remember how he talked to you? Remember how he came to your house? Could you not picture out from memory that what he looked like? I didn't try that. I said, now try that. And I am going to now, under my master's instruction, going to come back again in 6 months and check out what happens. So I did go after 6 months. He made more progress and had such great experiences in 6 months he had never had in 40 years. I'm just telling you that one small missing part, that the meditation was mechanical. It's not a mechanical thing. We're talking spirituality. We're not talking of training the body or training the mind. We're talking of spirituality. It lies above the mind. Love and devotion takes you above the mind. And that's why he then made all that progress. So it's so important to remember these key things. Also, one other little thing that I got into trouble with when I got initiated. And Master said, place yourself behind the eyes. I thought, I have to place a small image of myself. Close my eyes, look at my small image. There I am sitting in the center of the head. I tried that. I thought that's what he meant. That place yourself, center of the head, behind the eyes. So I closed my eyes. I said, there I am. I could see myself. Of course, it had to be small. The head is small. So I put myself there and stared at that self of mine. Nothing happened. I stared every day. It took me years. Say, what kind of meditation is this? So I went back to Master. I said, Master, you told me that in order to start meditation, don't even start repetition of word, don't start anything till you have placed yourself behind the eyes. You keep on giving this instruction and I keep on placing myself. He says, you're not placing yourself, you're placing a little image of yourself. You know who you are? The one looking at that image. You are behind. You're creating an image. And then he told me another wonderful thing. He said, the image you are seeing is not inside you at all, it's outside. So he gave me a little exercise to do to show how that image was outside. He says, close your eyes. Can you still see the image? Yes, I can see. I see it every day. So I close my eyes. He says, when your eyes are open, you want to touch your eyes with your hands. Can you do it? Very easy. I know where my eyes are. Close your eyes. Can you still touch them? Yes, I know where they are. Now make that image and bring your hands up and touch them slowly. So I made that image inside. I brought my hands. I brought my hands. When I came here, the image was outside. And I all the time thought it was inside. We make these imaginary images. They are not inside at all. Who is inside? The one looking at the image. Very fundamental change took place. The very secret of starting good meditation started that day. That I am not supposed to make any image at all. I am supposed to be there. I am supposed to be that person, that being, sitting. The moment I tried to place myself there, they had expanded to a room. And I was the same size as this. Perhaps sometimes bigger, sometimes smaller. It did not matter at all. That the space, that the dark space behind the eyes, and I'm giving you a very practical tip now, because so many of us may be caught up in this, that unless you are yourself there, and you know that your body is around you, that your eyes are in front of you, your ears are on the side of you, the throat is below you, your rest of the body is below you, you are there, yourself. Not that you are looking at yourself, you are there. That's when you should start meditation. And then the attention gathers. After a couple of days, I told Great Master, it's very hard to do that. Every time I start doing that, I come back into this body. Every time I start to feel I am there, I suddenly realize I am talking of this body. It's so difficult to pull this body into that place. Then he gave me another tip, which I'm going to share with you. He said, you have to use imagination to place yourself there. Imagination is a tool. It does not mean that just because it's imaginary, it's not real or real. It's a tool to put yourself, your attention behind the eyes. Imagine you are there. And then he gave an example. He says, raise your hand, figure right up, where you can't even see it. Imagine you are sitting on top there. Can you imagine? Yes, I can imagine. That's just imagination. Yes, I am there. Bring it slowly. Are you still there? Yes. Are you still there? Yes. Are you still here? Yes. Now jump inside. I jumped in. So it looks so simple after that. That is pure imagination. It's not a stress or strain to get there. And when we get that, imagine there's a house, we're there and we just jumped in. We're sitting there moving around. I'm moving around. I'm looking right or left. When that happened, meditation became successful from that day onwards. So I'm giving you a little practical tip from my own life. And these, sometimes a little mistake like that can go on for years without our noticing it, because nobody to guide us. That's another important thing I want to mention, that when you are serious about the spiritual path and you want to really practice and get benefit out of it, anytime you have a problem in it, you must check with the Master. Don't just sit, one day I will get it. That's blind faith. If you just sit on blind faith and say, one day it will happen. Of course, with a tongue in cheek, I can say, one day it will happen. But if you want to seriously examine, and your mind is strong and skeptical, like mine was, a highly skeptical mind, unless I can see, I can't believe it. I can take it up to a point, but proof must come. I was that kind of a guy. So once you are like that, you must examine while you are here. Must test it out. And if you know while you are here, one big advantage is this life changes completely. The biggest problem in our life here is insecurity and fear and doubt going on all the time. We don't know what's going to happen. We are afraid even of death. We are afraid of what will happen tomorrow. We are constantly in a state of fear and insecure. Once you get that experience, there's no fear and there's no insecurity. You become totally fearless and you become totally secure. And that feeling of being with the Master, who takes great care of you, and you have 24/7 companionship, nothing like that. So that's why there are so many advantages of a path like this, where you have a perfect living Master in a human form who is a friend of yours. That's the secret. So I'm very happy to share all this with you. Thank you.